tearing through the dead of night. Oh, see the kingdom burst. See the kingdom burst into color at the speed of light. Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. Shaking up the atmosphere as the shadows fade. As the shadows fade into nothing as the day appears. Let's sing it out. Beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us. The everlasting one, Jesus our God. Let's sing it out. Oh, we look to the sun.
You alone have made a way for us. Hear your love. You are love. You are the
sing that chorus out again to the Lord, not to us. Sing, not to us, but to your name. We lift up, oh, praise. Not to us, not to us, but to your name. We lift up, oh, praise. Not to us, not to us, but to your name. We lift up, oh, praise. Not to us, not to us, but to your name. We lift up, oh, praise. You are the Lord Almighty. How shining on the stars in glory. Sing, your love is like the wildest ocean. Shining on the stars in glory. Your love is like the wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares. Lord, we're here today not to go to a building or not to sing a bunch of songs. We're here to lift you up, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the one who was and is to come. And we bring you our hearts today with all that we are, with all that we have. We bring all of us today. Let's sing it out.
Sing, here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord.
Speak what is true.
Speak what is true.
Here's my heart.
Here's my heart, Lord.
Here's my heart.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my I am found, I am yours, I am loved, I'm made pure, I have life, I can breathe, I am here, I am free. Here's my life. God, today we thank you that man looks on the outside, but God, you look on the heart. You're not so much interested in our church attendance. You're not so much interested on how much we give or the places that we go. You're interested in all those things, but you're interested in our hearts. You're interested in us. We thank you for that today, that you're a God of relationship.
I am found, sing. I am yours. I am loved. I'm made pure. I have life. I can breathe. I am here. I am free.
You are strong.
Sing, you are strong. You are sure.
Sing, here's my life.
Sing, here's my life, Lord.
Here's my life.
Here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord.
Speak what is true.
Speak what is true. Speak what.
Your song now. Here's my heart.
Here's my heart.
Here's my heart. Here's my heart. Speak what is true. Speak what is true. Speak what is true. Here's my life, see. Here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Here's my life. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is true. Speak what is true. What is true? Speak what is true. Speak what is true. What is true? Speak what is true.
God, we thank you that today that we're in this place. We sent your spirit here in this place. We know that you're with us. And God, we want to bring you an offering, a sacrifice of praise, but God, not one of just singing songs to you, not just one of coming to church, but God, one of our very life, a life that's yielded to you, God, a life that's surrendered to you. God, we just thank you. We praise you for Jesus in this place, that you're not a God who's far off and who's left us by ourselves, but you're a God that's here with us, that is for us, and you're with us. And if you're with us, who can be against us? We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen. You can turn and say good morning to someone around you today. Just welcome those around you for a few moments. Introduce yourself to a couple folks today.
Hello, and welcome to Calvary Chapel Vale Valley. I'm Crystal Wolf, and I'm blessed to have the opportunity to work with this church as the administrative assistant. I'd like to share some announcements with you today. We're going to take this morning's offering now. This is a chance to give back to the Lord with what He has blessed us with. You can either drop your offering in the bag as it goes by, or you can give online or by texting the number on the screen. This month, we're checking in to support Jim and Joanna Jose, our missionaries in Uganda. They're serving with EMI. Go to Facebook and check in or tag us in a photo on Instagram. Another one of the missions trips this year is heading back to India. If you're interested in going this year or would just like more information, please join us July 1st after the 10:30 service. We'll meet in the youth hallway, and you can sign up to let us know you're coming. Join us for Salute to the USA this year. Sign up and help serve and love on our community. We need around 100 volunteers between 4:30 and 9:30 p.m. We also need bags of individually wrapped pieces of candy to give out as prizes. So bring your donations to church on Sunday or to the event. Vacation Bible School is July 23rd through 27th from 9 to noon. Have your kids join us for a great week of learning about Jesus. You can register your kids on our website right on the homepage or under the events tab. If you're interested in serving with them for the week, go to our app or website and sign up. We're looking for junior high school, and adult volunteers. Thanks for being here with us. If you have any questions about anything that you've heard today, or to find out more information, please stop by our connections table in the lobby or visit us online. Have a great day.
Good morning. How's everybody doing today? Good, good. So glad to be with you this morning. I have just a couple things to let you know about before we get into our study today. The first one is that if you are a visitor with us this morning, we just want you to know that we're so glad that you're here, that you chose to spend your Sunday morning with us, and we hope that you're blessed by your time this morning. If that's you and you're a visitor, we have something we want to give you. And so we have a little mug and a Starbucks card that we want to give you just to say thanks for being with us this morning. And so all we ask for in exchange for that is your social security number, name, address, all that stuff. Just kidding. But we would like to know that you are here. And so you can check in at the welcome table out in the foyer on your way out today and grab that. We'd love to hook you up. Also, if you've been coming for a little while and haven't had the opportunity to get connected and plugged in, I'm going to tell you about two important ways to really get connected and engaged at church. And the first one is to get on a team, okay? To get on a team. And so we have service teams in all different areas of ministry here. You can serve at the greeting table. You can serve with helping set up food, setting up chairs. You can do kids ministry. We have stuff throughout the week, outreach opportunities. It's a great way to get plugged in and get to know some people. So get on a team. And the second one is to get in a group. And so we have small groups that meet throughout the week. We call them our connect groups. And so we have groups that center around Bible studies. We have groups, men's groups and women's groups and co-ed groups and mountain bike groups and all kinds of groups. And so get on a team and get in a group. And you can do all of that on our app, on the website, or out at the info table in the foyer. And then two other things I want to cover today. One is that many of you probably know or have at least heard that there is a group that is in town right now protesting at several different churches. It's the Westboro Baptist Church group, and you may have heard of them over the years. They are a cult, really, essentially, and a hate group, and they're going around to different churches in the valley protesting, and thankfully they're not coming to our church today, but I want to make sure to pray for the churches that they are visiting. And so let's take just a second and lift those churches up to the Lord. Lord, we just come before you, and we lift up those churches in our valley that are being protested this morning by this group, Lord. We pray that you would just fill them with grace and love, and that they would show your love, even to the people that are coming to spew hate. Lord, I pray that they would experience the love of a God who died on a cross for them to give them life. And so, Lord, I pray that this would ultimately turn out for your glory, Lord, that people would look in and see the difference between that group and the people that they're coming and protesting, Lord. And I pray that your glory would show through it. And so we lift this up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. And then the last thing that I want to cover today before we get into our study is that Jake and Alicia Fries, Jake, who has been on staff with us for about 4 years, we shared a while back that they are feeling called by the Lord to step out in a new adventure, and they're going to be moving to the Front Range. And so today is their last official Sunday with us, and so we want to send them off well. And so I want to invite Jake and Alicia up here to the stage. Come on up here, guys. And these guys have both served faithfully for several years here at Calvary, and God is calling them on to new things, and so we want to lift them up before the Lord together. So let's pray over them. Lord, we thank you for Jake and Alicia. We thank you for their heart to follow you. We thank you for the things that you've done in their lives, Lord, the ways that you've used them in this community, in this church. We're so blessed by them, Lord, and we know that they're going to be a blessing wherever they go. And so we pray that you would fill them with your spirit, that they would be guided by you, Lord, that you would direct their steps. We pray that where they land, Lord, that they would see fruit and that they'd grow in their relationship with you, Lord, and that you would use them greatly for your kingdom. And so we're so thankful for them, Lord. We're sad to see them go, but we're excited to see them step out in faith and trust you, Lord, and to walk with you. And so we pray your blessing and your anointing over them. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome. Thanks, guys. All right. If you have your Bible with you, go ahead and turn open to Nehemiah chapter 3. If you don't have your Bible today, we will have the verses up on the screen, but we're going to continue our study through the book of Nehemiah. And if you haven't been with us to this point, I want to give you just a little bit of a frame of reference of what it is that we're talking about. And so Nehemiah is in the Old Testament, and it's the history of how God called a man named Nehemiah to step out in faith and see God use him to rebuild a city and a wall that had been torn down around the city for nearly 200 years. And so we've been looking as we've gone through at the different aspects of this and him praying in preparation and him stepping out in faith and trusting God to use him as he made that step and all the different things that go into this. And it's been an amazing journey getting through that. And last week, you know, we got to this point where they started the actual work of building. We'd seen everything else come up to that point, and they started to put their hands to the work and build the wall around Jerusalem. And we looked at where they started. This group started on the foundation of their relationship with Christ. And they started at what's called the Sheep Gate, which is in the New Testament where Jesus would have walked in to go and stand trial as the Lamb of God that we know was slain. And so just incredible imagery there that their starting point, their foundation was laid on relationship with Jesus Christ. And so kind of our point from last week was, if you want to see God restore and rebuild and renew your life, which is our theme for this book, that you've got to start on the foundation of Jesus' love for you, on that relationship with Jesus Christ. Well, this week we move on into the next section and we're going to see how they actually started building the wall and who was doing the work and what it looked like and what they did. And so, I really believe that God wants to break into your world a little bit this morning. You might be here today and just kind of, maybe you had a long weekend, maybe you've had a long week, maybe you've had a long life, and you're like, I'm just done this morning. And I think that God wants to take those blinders off and speak directly to your heart this morning. And so I want to pray that he does that for each of us. And so would you pray with me right now? Lord, we come before you and we ask that you would break away those things that would distract us this morning. We come with expectation, just looking to have you speak directly to our hearts, Lord. We want to receive from you. We want you to move, that you would challenge us, Lord, in those areas that we need to be challenged, that you would exhort us and comfort us in those places that we need comfort, Lord. We ask that you would speak through your word in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so thinking about this idea of this wall around Jerusalem getting rebuilt, right? Imagine yourself being a Jew, a person of the nation of Israel, there in Jerusalem at this time, and this guy named Nehemiah comes into town and says, hey, you know that wall that's been torn down for 200 years around the city? Let's rebuild that. And you're looking at that and you're saying, I've never seen that thing built. It's been a shambles my whole life. You look around and it's like this, these bricks just laying all over the place, just a mess. How do you expect to get that done? You're looking at it, it's like the project is too big. It's huge. This wall was 16 feet thick and 4.5 miles in circumference, built out of stones and beams and timbers. It was just a massive project. Imagine being there and thinking, man, like, how is that ever going to get done? I mean, I'd like to see that happen, but how is it ever going to get done? This is a really big wall to get built. Well, you know, I think looking at the state of our nation and our world today, man, it's very obvious that we live in a very dark world. We look around and you see the hatred that comes from so many different places. You see something that just blows your mind in its severity about the way that people treat other people. You see terrorist attacks. You see things like I was reading a while back in these parents had starved their teenage child to death, locked them in a room, and made them wear diapers. They couldn't have access to the bathroom, and this child died. I mean, it's like, how do people even do that? And you think about it, it's like, man, like this is just insurmountable. How do we combat the darkness in this world? How do we even make a dent? I mean, it just make you feel like, how do I even do something? I'm just one person. You know, every once in a while, we kind of forget and we think that people are basically good and the world is basically safe. And then we get rudely awakened again by another act of violence, another thing that happens. It just blows your mind. What can I do? I'm just one person. Maybe you're here this morning and you've got darkness in your life. And it's not really the darkness in the world that's bothering you, but it's like the stuff that you can't seem to get over, the stuff that you can't seem to let go, the bitterness that you've got in your heart towards someone, and you're like, I can't even go there. How do I even step over that? That sin that you're holding on to. How do I put this thing down that I keep going back to? And the wall, the project seems insurmountable. How do I even put my hands to the work? And you look at it, and it's like, it's just like this, just these broken down bricks, and it's a mess. What do I do? How can I even begin to see that restoration? Well, I think we get a hint today in our study in Nehemiah chapter 3. So turn there with me, Nehemiah chapter 3. We're going to start in verse 2. And it says this, next to Eliashib, which if you remember from last week, Eliashib was the high priest, and so the priest built the sheep gate, and this is kind of moving on. Next to Eliashib, the men of Jericho built, and next to them, Zakur, the son of Imri, built. Also the sons of Hassanah built the fish gate. They laid its beams and hung its doors with its bolts and bars. And next to them, Meremoth, the son of Urijah, the son of Koz made repairs. Next to them, Meshullam, the son of Berechiah, the son of Meshezabel, made repairs. Next to them, Zadok, son of Bana, made repairs. And so you look at this, my first thought is like, man, they had some weird names in the Old Testament, right? Like, if you're looking for baby names, I think like Zadok might be a good one, right? Or Merimoth. What's your child's name? Merimoth? Okay. Is this like a Godzilla movie or what? What are you talking? Interesting names, right? But what I want you to notice here as we're looking through this section is not the names, but that the names are all different. See, it wasn't that there was one group of people that went around and built the entire wall all the way around the city. It was different people building at different places all around the wall. It wasn't that there was one group that went and built here and then built next to it and built next to it. It was different people building in each and every section. Look with me in verse 5. It says, next to them, the Tekoites made repairs, but their nobles did not put their shoulders to the work of their Lord. Now, I think this is an interesting note right here. So as it says, this group of this tribe, this group of Jews put their shoulders to the work, but their nobles didn't, right? They thought they were too good for the work. They were just too high, too powerful. They don't stoop down to that level. And just one little side note is, man, don't ever think that you're above any level of work when it comes to serving the Lord. Don't ever say that you're too good for that. Don't ever think that you're too high and mighty for that. Because the reality is, when you do that, God humbles you, just as he did the Tekoite nobles, because now, for the rest of history, they're recorded as being lazy, you know, too good to do the work type of guys, right? So the rest of history, like, they're sitting up there, if they're saved, they're sitting up there in heaven being like, man, really? God, did you have to put that verse in the Bible? I know I was wrong, but come on. All right. So look with me at verse 6. It says, moreover, Jehoiada, the son of Paseah, and Meshullam, the son of Bosadiah, repaired the old gate, and they laid its beams and hung its doors with its bolts and bars. And next to them, Melatiah, the Gibeonite, Jadon, the Maranathanite, I can't even say these words, the men of Gibeon and Mizpah repaired the residences of the governor of the region beyond the river. Next to him, Uzziel, the son of Harhiah, one of the goldsmiths, made repairs. Also next to him, Hananiah, one of the perfumers, made repairs. And they fortified Jerusalem as far as the broad wall. And next to them, Raphiah, the son of Hur, made repairs. Next to them, Jediah, the son of Haramath, made repairs in front of his house. Next to him, Hattush, the son of Hashabniah, made repairs. Malchijah, the son of Harim, and Hashub, the son of Pathath Moab, repaired another section, as well as the Tower of the Ovens. And next to him was Shalom, the son of Halohesh, leader of the half-district of Jerusalem. He and his daughters made repairs. Okay, so now I want you to notice, again, beyond the names, who the people are that are doing this work. It's all different people. In fact, it's people of all different trades. It wasn't that Nehemiah went and said, okay, who are the masons? Who are the stoneworkers? Who are the carpenters? Let's get all of those people together, and then we're going to take those people and build the wall. That's not what Nehemiah did. He brought everybody in. Everybody played a part. The whole group of people, all of them. There were the leaders that were there. There were the goldsmiths that were there. The guy that's making perfume is there putting rocks up on the wall. A guy and his daughters, which would have been in that day and age like an inappropriate thing. Like they were doing it. Everybody in the city was putting their hands to the work. It wasn't one group. It was everybody. They were all in. All the people, young and old, skilled, unskilled, everyone was doing the work. And so my first note for us is this: God doesn't save his work for qualified people. God doesn't save his work for qualified people. He's not looking for qualified people to do the work. If you're there, he's calling you to do it. See, the work of God is not just for those who are in professional ministry. That's not what he's looking for. He's looking for people who are available and willing. See, God wants to turn off the dark in this world and turn off the dark in your life, to build the wall, to shine the light of his love through the church, through you and me. And he's not looking for you to have everything figured out and all together. It's kind of like I went camping with my family for the past couple days. We got back yesterday. And the first night we were there, Thursday night, we got in a little bit late. We set up camp a little bit late. And so we started this fire at like 9:30 or something like that. We're just hanging out outside, sitting around the fire, chatting, you know, kind of hanging out. And at about midnight, this rainstorm started. It was totally peaceful and calm, and then suddenly it starts raining. I'm like, oh, man, okay. So we were in, like, the one place in the state that doesn't have a fire ban right now, up by Steamboat Lake. And so we're there, and it's like, okay, well, you know, we'll kind of put the fire out a little bit, but the rain's coming down, so it's not going to be a big deal. Well, suddenly the rain stopped, and this gust of wind came through that was, like, literally 40-mile-an-hour winds, just whoosh. Like crazy. I mean, the people that were in tents that night got woken up because the tent was smacking them in the face, right? It was just crazy wind. And we're sitting there watching, and I walked back to the camper to go get something to kind of try to get some water to put on the fire. And my wife is like yelling at me like, Nate, what's going on? I look over, and literally the wind had picked the fire up out of the fire pit, and it was blowing it all over our campsite, everywhere. Embers, sparks, logs on fire, just blowing all over the place. And we're like, no, like, you know, just freaking out. Cause like, I'm not the guy that's going to leave my fire and have it start a forest fire. Like, I'm super careful about that stuff, but there was nothing I could do right then. It's just blowing all over the place. So picture that, think what you're going to do in that moment, right? Okay, well, what are we going to do? You're going to get water. You're going to try to scoop everything back in, cover it with dirt, do all that stuff. We were doing that. But imagine now, if I watched that, and I watched all those embers come out of the thing, and I watched all that sparks shooting all over the place and logs blowing out of the fire pit. And I looked at that and I said, man, I'm really not qualified to put that out. Like, I wish Michael Warmoth was here right now. He'd be able to do that. But I'm not qualified to put out a fire. I don't know what I'm doing, especially when it's spreading out like that. I mean, I really don't have the qualifications to make sure this doesn't turn into a forest fire. How silly would that be? Of course. Like, I was the most qualified person in the world in that moment, right? There was nobody else more qualified than me in that situation to put that fire out. And see, this is what it's like in the world. We are the most qualified person in our sphere of influence. D.L. Moody, who was a great preacher in the 1800s, I mean, God used him in radical ways. He would get up there and he'd speak and there'd be 30,000 people there. And think about this, no amplification. I always wonder how they did that. Packing 30,000 people into this hall, he's teaching, and no amplification, no microphone, they're all listening. This guy was an amazing evangelist. God used him incredibly. But here's the thing. D.L. Moody had a fifth grade education in a day when it was common to have a doctorate as a pastor or a preacher. He applied for church membership at one point and was denied. They denied him membership in the church because they said that he was unlikely to ever become a productive member of society. Think about that. Imagine getting that on your little church membership stamp. Denied. You're never going to be productive in society. Wow. This guy, God used radically in an amazing way. And he had this to say. He said, if this world is going to be reached, I'm convinced that it must be done by men and women of average talent. Average talent. See, God's not looking for the most qualified person. He's looking for the person who's there. Paul said in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12 and 13, he said, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who has enabled me because he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Although I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and an insolent man, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly and in unbelief. See, Paul had put his trust in Jesus, and God took him and made him all the things that he became. See, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ today, if you belong to Jesus today, you are in ministry. You are in full-time ministry, whether you realize it or not. See, ministry doesn't mean being a pastor on stage speaking. Ministry means being a part of the body of Christ and doing the work on the wall that God has called you to do. See, it says God has counted you faithful. Think about that just for a second. God has looked at you and counted you faithful with the ministry that he has in your life. That means he trusts you. He has entrusted you with the ministry that he's called you to. Each and every one of you. We all have it. I mean, think about that just for a second. The God who holds the universe. We talked about this a few weeks ago that our God is big, immeasurably bigger than we can imagine. He trusts you to do the work of the ministry that he's called you to. He trusts you to build the wall that's in front of you, to turn off the dark, that's in front of you. I mean, it's a little bit scary, isn't it? It's kind of like, wow, okay, that's a big responsibility. I don't know if I'm up for that. See, God knows you're up for it. He's the one who gave it to you. You know, sometimes I think God must not know what he's doing in calling me to be a pastor. Like, really? I don't know. Like, I don't know if I'm the best person for the job, Lord. I mean, I'm just a punk kid. Literally, I used to play in a punk rock band. But, you know, I didn't go to seminary. In fact, I didn't want to be a pastor. I actually fought being a pastor for a very long time. I said, I don't want to do that. I want to do music. I don't want to be a pastor. But somehow God has his way of chipping away at you until you give in and you realize that his way really is better than your way, right? Like, wow, God, you're right. I should be doing things the way that you say I should be doing them. But it's funny because, like, I'm not a naturally extroverted person. In fact, I'm an introvert by nature. And so, like, when I'm talking to you and, like, the conversation dies, I'm totally okay with that. It's like, all right, see you later. You know, I'm going to go hang out at my house now. It's like, God, it's just like, God, what are you thinking? Why would you put me there? You ever feel like that? Like, God, why would you put me in this situation? I'm not qualified to do that. When I think of the pastors and the teachers and the evangelists that I look up to, I think of like Greg Laurie. I think of Louis Giglio or Billy Graham or these guys that God has used in great ways. And I'm like, man, I'm no Greg Laurie. I'm no Louis Giglio. I'm no Billy Graham. I mean, God, why would you put me in this position? I'm not any of those guys. I can't be like that. Maybe you've had a similar thought to that. With whatever God's put in front of you, you're like, God, I can't do that. I'm not qualified for that. I'm not talented enough. I'm not skilled enough. I don't have the right personality or charisma. I don't have enough, you know, oomph to do that. I'm not the right person for the job. You know, it's interesting. You look throughout Scripture and so many people said that. Moses. I mean, he's like, God, send somebody else. I can't talk. Send somebody else. God's like, fine. You're the guy. You can have your brother Aaron. He can speak for you, but you're the guy, right? Over and over and over again throughout Scripture, God chooses people who say, I'm not good enough for that. Gideon, right? Angel appears to him and says, hey, mighty man of valor. And Gideon's like, I don't know what you're talking about. I've never fought a battle in my life. That's what God does. If you're there and you're thinking, man, God, why would you call me to do this? Why would you put me here? I have two answers that I really believe answer that question. Why would God call you to be in that position? The first one is this. To see, for me specifically, God not only chose to put me in this position, but he actually chose not to put Greg Laurie or Billy Graham or Louis Giglio in my position. It's not only that he chose me to be a pastor here, but he chose not to make one of those other guys a pastor here. Now, you might be wishing that one of those other guys was the pastor here, but God knows better, right? He knows that I'm the person that needs to be here. He chose not to put one of them here because, see, here's the thing. They are not me. Just as much as I'm not them, they're not me. And see, God has chosen you for the role that he's called you to. And in the same way, he's chosen not to put anybody else in that role because nobody else can be you. Nobody else can be the person that you are. There is no one else on earth who can be who God designed you to be. Nobody. He's designed you uniquely, individually, and there's no one else on earth who can be who God designed you to be. The second one is this. The first one is that you are unique. God has placed you there on purpose. The second one is this. God is in the business of showing his glory, not your glory. See, if God takes someone that's incredibly naturally gifted and naturally talented and naturally capable, and he sticks them in a position and then they do all the things that they naturally do, well, then it's like, oh, that's a cool person. They're great. But if God takes someone who is a school dropout like D.L. Moody that only got a fifth grade education, that got told by a church, hey, you're never going to be a productive member of society, but then he raises that person up and that person has a ministry that reaches hundreds of thousands of people, who gets the glory then? God gets the glory. See, God is in the business of showing his glory, not yours. And so because of that, God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. God is not looking for people with the right credentials to serve. He's looking for people who are willing and available. Look with me at 1 Corinthians chapter 1. verse 26 through 29. I think there's not a clearer section of scripture that speaks to this that I'm talking about. I love this. It says this. For this is Paul speaking, and he's speaking to the Corinthian church. And he says, "For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised God has chosen. And the things which are not to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence." See, when you look around at the church, we're a bunch of misfits. We're foolishness to the world. In fact, if you put this in modern terms, Paul says, hey, church, like, look around at yourselves. So do that for a second. Look around at everybody that's around you, right? Look around at yourselves. And he says this, you are all average to below average. Wow, that's super encouraging, Paul. I don't know. I thought I'm supposed to be like extraordinary because God created me. He's saying, no, you're actually boringly normal. Wow, Paul must not have had the spiritual gift of encouragement, right? It's like, wow, that's a way to lift somebody's spirit up, is tell them that they're boringly normal, right? But see, here's what he's saying. God has intentionally chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. He's chosen those of us who on our own don't measure up to much so that he gets the glory. And yet God, in spite of our weakness, in spite of being boringly normal, God has counted you faithful, putting you into ministry because he wants to show his glory. See, God is in the business of showing how powerful, how mighty he is. And when he takes the weak and the foolish things and uses them, it shows his glory. It shows his might. It shows his power. And so if you're here today and you feel unqualified, if you're here today and you feel like, man, I'm not good enough, I'm not smart enough, I can't speak well enough, I can't do well enough, I'm just not good enough to be used by God in this world, in this ministry, man, you are the perfect candidate for what God wants to do. There is no one more qualified than you because God doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called. It's kind of like, I remember I was shopping this one time. I went to the grocery store and I walked in and there was this little old lady going up to grab a shopping cart. And she had to be 85 years old maybe. And she's walking up to go grab this shopping cart, you know. She was kind of hunched over a little bit and she's like going to grab it. And I'm like, oh, I'm going to go help the little old lady get the shopping cart out, right? Because, you know, sometimes they get jammed. She's kind of pulling on it. It's not working. And I went over to go help her. And then suddenly she grabs it and she goes, bam! And just slammed the thing out. I mean, like, she manhandled that shopping cart. I was like, oh, wow, okay, stand back. It was surprising, right? It was like, whoa, that was crazy. And see, that's what God wants to use you for. He wants the world to look in and be like, wow, that is amazing. How did that even happen? When he gets the glory. When he gets the glory. See, God wants to shock and awe the world with your life. He wants to put the wise to shame. He wants to use you for incredible things that you can't even think up. Okay, so we kind of get that. It's like, okay, well, God doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. I'm the perfect candidate. I am the person that God wants to use in this situation. So, well, how do I actually do that? I mean, we're talking about building this wall. It's a huge project. How do I even get in on there to be served and to be used by God in that way? Look with me. We're going to skip down to verse 28 because I don't want to read this long, long, long list of names. Skip to verse 28 and it says this. Beyond the horse gate, the priests made repairs, each in front of his own house. After them, Zadok, the son of Immer, made repairs in front of his own house. After him, Shemaiah, the son of Shechaniah, the keeper of the east gate, made repairs. After him, Hananiah, the son of Shelemiah, and Hanan, the sixth son of Zalaph, repaired another section. After him, Meshullam, the son of Berechiah, made repairs in front of his dwelling. Now, I want you to notice something here. Where are they building? They're building in front of their house. It's not that they're going somewhere else. They're building right in front of them. They look out their window and they say, man, the wall's broken down right here. That's where I'm going to start. I'm going to start building right where I am, right where God has placed me, right where my home is. That's the place that I can put my hands to the work. And so when you look at that wall, the city, the wall around the whole city getting built, it wasn't that there was, you know, they go out and they do this massive project. It's that each person took the spot right in front of them. They said, this spot, this is where God's called me to build. This is my sphere of influence. And see, if we want to see God use us to turn off the dark in this world, use us to reach the lost in this world, if we want to see God use us in our own lives to cast off those things that are darkness in our life, we start right in front of our own house, right in our sphere of influence. And so what is your sphere of influence? Where is the wall broken right in front of your house? Where has God called you to be? What's your section of the wall? Maybe if you're a teacher and it's your school ministering to the kids in that school. Maybe you're a homemaker and it's your kids and it's pouring into and teaching them about Jesus. Maybe you're a businessman and it's having solid business practices that point to the Lord. What is your section of the wall? What does it look like in your life? See, how do you build a wall, like a big giant wall? How do you actually get it built? Brick by brick, right? You take one brick, you put it on top of another brick. And then you take another brick, and you put it on top of that brick. And see, you might look at that wall and be like, you know what, I can't make a difference. I can't see anything change in this world. I'm just one person. What can I do? I only have one brick. And God's saying, yeah, you only have one brick, but I've got millions of other people who also have one brick. And when you all put your bricks together, suddenly you have this giant wall. And that's what God wants to do in his church. You may only have one brick, but you have to be faithful with that one brick that God has given you. You have to take that thing that God has put in your life and you say, God, I'm going to use this. I'm going to build in front of my house. I'm going to work on that thing that you've called me to do. And so I'm going to put my brick right there, and I'm going to watch what you do with my life. Take your one brick and work with that one brick. See, the job is much smaller when you look at just the one thing right in front of you. If you're trying to look at the whole wall, it's like, yeah, of course I can't make a difference. I can't fix that whole wall. I can't do anything about that. But I can take my one brick, and I can stick my one brick on that wall. And as God raises up his church, and we all put brick after brick after brick after brick, suddenly you look, and there's a wall there when there was none before. See, that's how God changes the world, one person at a time. See, God doesn't expect you to build the whole wall. It's a community thing, but God does expect you to use your sphere of influence to put your brick on the wall, to build in front of your house. And so I want you to think about, who are the people in your life that God has given you influence with? Who are the people in your life that God has given you natural influence with? The people in your neighborhood, the people in your workplace, the people in your friend group. What's the wall that's broken in front of your house? How might God use you to work in your workplace? What's that area that he's given you? Whatever it is, dig in and build. Take that brick that God's given you and put it on the wall. I want to challenge you this week. I want to give you a challenge this week. And it starts with this. Recognize that you are where you are and who you are on purpose, right? We talked about this in the whole Be Church series, that God has designed you specifically with very specific purposes. He has called you for such a time as this. But think about where you are in your life, the sphere of influence that you have in your life, at home, at work, at school, wherever it is. God has placed you there on purpose. Recognize that. And then look with spiritual eyes at your neighborhood. Look with spiritual eyes at your workplace. Look with spiritual eyes at your friend group to see how God might be working. And then join him where he's already working. And so here's my challenge for you, because you might be thinking, well, okay, like, yeah, I want to serve the Lord, but what am I called to do, and where am I called to be, and where am I called to go? And those are just big, giant questions that I can't give you the answer for, but I can tell you this. You have a brick that you can build with this week. Because when I say bigger picture calling, you're like, what is God calling me to do in my life? I don't think that's a question that we should really ever ask, because we only have today. Tomorrow's going to worry about itself. We only have what's right in front of us. And so you have one brick this week. And so my challenge for you this week is to recognize what that brick is, and then to put that brick on the wall. What is that thing that God would have you do this week? Maybe it's a family in your neighborhood that you know doesn't know the Lord, and it's just inviting them over to dinner to get to know him. Not with an agenda, but just saying, okay, Lord, what would you do? How would you open the door for me to minister to these people? Maybe for you, it's a coworker that you've noticed has been struggling, and it's like, hey, you want to go out to coffee and just chat? And all you do is sit there and listen, and if the opportunity presents itself, you ask if you can pray for them. Maybe you don't even, and yours is there. Maybe for you, it's reaching out to somebody that you've estranged from and trying to rebuild that relationship, or maybe it's just meeting somebody here at church. And you're like, man, I come in and I leave, and I don't ever want to get connected because I don't really want people to know me. Maybe it's saying, hey, I'm going to ask somebody to go grab lunch with me today. Maybe for you it's getting involved on a team or getting plugged into a group. Or maybe for you it's saying, you know what, I'm going to put down this addiction that I keep going back to. Or I'm going to put down this bitterness that I keep going back to. Each of us has a brick that we can put on the wall this week. And so my challenge for you is to do it. To ask the Lord, Lord, what would you have me do? What's the one thing that I can do to step outside my comfort zone and to put my brick on the wall this week? How can I build for your kingdom this week? Not big picture, this week, right here, right now. So I want you guys to all stand up with me together, and we're gonna take just a second, and we're gonna close our eyes. Just all stand up together, close your eyes, and I want you to just ask God right now. If you don't know what that brick might be, I want you to ask him to show you right in this time. Just take a second and say, Lord, show me. Show me the area that you've given me influence. Show me what you would have me do, where you would have me build. Maybe it's your family. Maybe it's the annoying neighbor across the street that you keep running into and you kind of avoid sometimes. Maybe it's a coworker or your boss. Maybe it's stepping out to give and to support a work of God overseas. Maybe it's saying, you know what, I'm going to step out and I'm going to sign up for that India mission trip this fall. What is it that God would have you do this week? What is the brick that he would have you place this week? Lord, we just come before you right now, humbled that you would choose to use people like us. That you would use people that are weak. That you would use people that might be considered foolishness to the world. That you would use people that have messed up time and time and time and time and time again. And we may look at our lives and say, I'm a failure. And you look at our lives and you say, that's the perfect canvas for me to work. And so, Lord, we are humbled by your great love and mercy over us, that you would trust us with your work, that you would trust us to build that wall that you want to build, Lord, that you would trust us to turn off the dark in this community, in this world, in our lives. And so right now, Lord, I pray that you would show us those areas of our lives that we can build this week, those places that we have a brick to put on the wall this week, Lord. Show us what those things are. And then, Lord, may we accept that challenge. And so I want you right now where you're standing, just for a second, I'm going to challenge you to commit to the Lord to putting that brick on the wall this week, okay? So right where you're sitting, between you and the Lord, I challenge you. And I know that might be scary because then you're committed to God and you're like, oh, I really better do it if I commit something to the Lord, right? That's the point. So I want you to take the second, pray to God and say, Lord, I'm going to put this brick on the wall this week and make that commitment. And Lord, we want to see you rebuild and renew and restore our lives. We want to see you rebuild and renew and restore our community. We want to see you rebuild and renew and restore your kingdom in this world, Lord. And we know that it's done one brick at a time, one person at a time, Lord. And so we choose to say yes to you. We will put our brick on the wall. We choose to say, yes, Lord, here I am. Send me where you want me to go. I'll go. I will respond in faith and trust in you. And so, Lord, I thank you for every heart that's here that is making that commitment this morning, Lord. I pray that you would fill us with your spirit this week, that we'd be able to do that. And Lord, I pray today for anybody that's here that's never put their trust in you. And they may be here first time ever at church. They may be here thinking like, okay, I don't really know about this whole thing. I don't know what's going on. Lord, I pray right now for anybody that's here that doesn't know you, that doesn't have a relationship with you, that's never put their trust in you, that you would speak to their heart right now. That by your Holy Spirit, you would draw them to yourself. And if you're here this morning, maybe you're visiting with us this morning, and maybe somebody else drug you here. Maybe you've been in church your whole life, but you've never had that relationship with God. I want to tell you that God loves you. He looks at you and he doesn't see failure. He sees someone that he loves desperately. He loves you enough that he sent his son to die on the cross for you 2,000 years ago. See, the reason Jesus had to die for you is because you and I, all of us, are sinners. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And sin is just a word to describe the fact that we've turned our back on God and said that our way is better. And the problem with our way is that the Bible says that there's a way that seems right to a man, but the end of it is death. Our way ends in death, an eternal separation from God. But see, God loves you so much that he can't stand the thought of you facing that. And so he did the only thing he could do. He became a man who came and lived among us, never sinned, and died on that cross to take the penalty that was due to us and give us life in its place. And so if you're here and you'd like to receive that gift of life that Jesus is offering, you'd like to put your trust in him, I want you just to pray this with me. You can pray in your own words. You can repeat after me. Say, Lord, thank you for loving me. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. I ask that you would forgive me for going my own way. I want to trust and follow you. I want to know you. So please make me yours. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take this time, and as we sing this next song, and really just worship the Lord and pour out our hearts to him. If you're here this morning and you need prayer for anything, I'd like to invite you to come up to the front. The prayer team will be up here at either side. We'd love to pray with you this morning. Make sure you don't leave without getting prayed for if you've got something going on in your life. So let's worship together.
Seated on your throne, you are forever, God incarnate.
So Lord, what could separate us from your love? Scriptures tell us nothing. There's nothing that can separate us from your love, Lord. And so Lord, we give you praise. You're worthy to be praised, Lord. And even when we look at our own unworthiness and our own averageness, Lord, and our own inability to do things, Lord, we know that you are greater. And so we lift your name higher, Lord, knowing that you can do that work of rebuilding in our lives, Lord, knowing that you can do that work of rebuilding in our community and in our world, Lord, and humbled by the fact that you want to use us to do that. And so we ask that you would fill us up this week, Lord, that as we go out and we accept that challenge to put that one brick on the wall this week, Lord, we pray that you would give us the strength by your Holy Spirit to do that. So we ask for your strength, Lord. We ask for your wisdom. Pray for your filling this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Awesome. Have a great week, guys. We'll see you back next Sunday.
And what can separate us from this amazing love? What can say it's greater than our God? Separate.